Great things!
Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Chair Reviews!
In which there will be some singing, as you heard. There will be some foxes wrestling people in wheelchairs, rather unkindly. There will be Robin Wright with a fish with a knob for a head. And there will be a man with a knob for a head. A big knob-headed man. that's just a hint of some of the films today. Although you might have read them in the box below this thing anyway. So, yeah, it's just a little game. Right, okay, here we go. Welcome then, welcome. The first film, as the wheelchair suggested, that I saw this week. Actually, it's not the first film I saw this week. It's the first cinema. Let's do the cinema films first. It's the first cinema film I saw this week. And that is The Theory of Everything. The Theory of Everything. Yeah, I might sue over the title. It didn't have The Theory of Everything in it. I think that's a bummer. I expected to get more out of this. It is the story, as well advertised, of Stephen Hawking. Not Stephen Hawkins, not Stephen Hawking's football boots. Stephen Hawking, the brilliant scientist who was a Cambridge lad when he unfortunately got motor neuron disease, or neuron disease, and started his descent into, well, kind of almost paralysis, really. But pretty much paralysis, but not technically. It's directed by Jake Marsh, who previously just did documentaries, things like Man on a Wire and Project Nim. Project Nim I watched recently. It was really good, actually, about a chimpanzee. Check it out. It's directed by him. It stars Eddie Redmayne. Eddie Redmayne? It is Eddie Redmayne. It's not Harry, is it? It's Eddie Redmayne. Eddie, good old Eddie. You may know as the fish mouth boy from The Good Shepherd. And he was also in Les Mis, which will come up later as well. He was also in Les Miserables, the film version last year. And it also stars... I can't remember her name, and I love her. What's her name? It's the girl... I'm going to have to do it now. What an idiot. It's Felicity Jones. It's Felicity Jones. Sorry about that. Felicity Jones, who is just wonderful. She's a quintessential English Rose. I think she's really, really good. She's really proving that in this generation of young actors that's kind of forcing their way into Hollywood big time now. So it stars those two. She as his girlfriend, then wife. Him as the titular, not the titular man, but him as Hawking. And it's good. It's shot in this kind of yellowy brown hue so that you know you're in the 60s and 70s. Started off and I was like, wow, I'm going to really like this film. It does what the British film industry does best. Shows Cambridge, shows people at big universities talking poshly and, being all English, really, for the Americans. Yeah, so and it's a great film. I'm watching his descent. It is a really good performance. There are a couple of times. It's a difficult one. It's a difficult one, isn't it? I think the lad from Breaking Bad's recently been on the television saying, "Well, you know, surely disabled people should play disabled people." It's a bit of a toughie because he's quite disabled by the end, isn't he? But he does a really good job, Redmayne. There are a couple of... let's just say that the performances are very, very good. Felicity Jones, I think... There's a couple of times when I saw the performance, maybe. But generally not. Generally not. I mean, she's very, very good. And there are a couple of really, really moving scenes between these people. Because it's not just a straight... it's obviously not a happy story. Not quite, anyway. But things don't go exactly to plan for them outside the events that they already knew about. And there are some interesting layers about relationships and stuff that are in there, and that, you know, there's some fascinating stuff in there. And the performances are really, really good. And Redmayne, as I was saying, he puts some of these little glances and eye movements, particularly when he's found something to laugh about, particularly when he's being a bit mischievous, because this is a normal guy. Of course it is. But when when he's being a bit mischievous or something like that, it really, really works. And as I say, yeah, the scenes between them, some with some quite emotional heft, really, really work. And a little bit of a tear in the eye. Very, very good. And as it goes on, yeah, so I liked the film. And I'm not going to say it's a downfall, but here's a limitation on the film. Its reach is exactly the same as its grasp. This is safety. This is safety Oscar stuff. Now, I enjoyed it. As I say, I was moved. I laughed. It was a good drama about some people struggling with an illness. I did see someone write saying, well, it could have been anyone, really. And that is another point about the safety, really. This man is a scientist, as you well know. And I think that offered a lot of scope to do things visually. And to have a little bit more science. I would have liked more science. You know, I'm that side of the fence. I would have liked that a bit more than some of the dramatic stuff. The lovey stuff. And the non-lovey stuff. Which is a little bit, not every day, but it doesn't pertain particularly to him. His condition, yes, but perhaps not his mind. And I would have liked a little bit more of the mind, and I think you could have done more things with that, more visually arresting things. But it's still, the film looks nice, it's very solid, it's a good one, I would suggest to watch it. I'm going to give it a throne. All I'm saying is it's a bit safe. But very good, good performances, like it. One throne there, so it's a good start. The next one is Foxcatcher. Foxcatcher is really, really good as well. Two films that really depend on their performances. And this one really does as well, yeah. Obviously, two films. This is the second one. Steve Carell plays Jean Dupont. This is a true story, by the way. Who is this... Yeah, he's a descendant. It's called Foxcatcher because all their descendants used to be Git, RC Toffs riding around Pennsylvania and New England tearing foxes to shreds. This is about their descendants mainly, or one of them, and they're no better. They haven't got to be better people for not doing that. It's about this guy, and he's a wrestling coach, or he wishes to be a wrestling coach. He's an aspiring wrestling coach. He's just got a love of wrestling, which is weird anyway, I think, a little bit. That's played by Steve Carell with some quite fierce prosthetics on, with a big nose and manky teeth. And the wrestlers are Channing Tatum and Mark Ruffalo. Mark Ruffalo, who I really like in almost everything, and Channing Tatum, who I like in the Jump Street films. He's fine. You know, he's fine. He's a big, hunky guy, isn't he? That's not my words. And it's about, bravo first off for the film, because I did not know what this was about. I don't like wrestling. Well, I'm not into it, certainly. No, I don't. I'll stick with that. I don't even like it. It's shit. Now, wrestling's crap. It's for bennies. Bravo to them for having a trailer that I went into the film and I didn't know what it was bloody about. I hadn't seen any of the last scenes. And it worked for me. So Channing and Mark Ruffalo play these brothers who are wrestlers, and they've already won Olympic gold medals, and he says to them, I want you to come to my big grounds and train an Olympic wrestling team to win in Seoul in 2 years' time. And Channing Tatum says yes, and Mark Ruffalo says no, and Channing Tatum goes, and and the story unfolds, and I won't give too much more away about the story. So he goes there to this camp, to this sort of camp that this guy set up. Let me talk about the guys. Jean Dupont is a creepy git weirdo, just a horrible person. He is a man who craves adulation, and he is willing to pay for it, and it's just corrupted his soul. He's a manky git, and you see him in all these things, and with the team trying to garner this image for himself, and it's really creepy. It's quite wonderful, actually. It's very disturbing. You're watching going, who's this guy? Who is this guy? And it's really odd. It's very strange. So worthy that he's getting a lot of credit for that, because you never think that you're looking at Steve Carell. It's a solid performance. Channing Tatum as well, I think, is really, really good in this. Normally, he is this hunky, sort of charismatic guy, isn't he, in the Jump Street films and such. But he's not in this. He is a lump that you wouldn't want sitting next to you on the bus. He's that bloke who gets on with tracky bottoms and just going with face and neck. He's really, really frightening. Not frightening, but he's just an absolute simpleton, and he's doing it really well. And then there's Mark Ruffalo, who's like the most normal of the three. And yeah, so I can't tell you too much about the story, but let's say it's about these relationships between these three people that twist and turn. And it's mainly about DuPont and the way that he twists things, because he's such an irregular fucking... He's such a weird guy. And things go wrong. Things basically gradually go wrong between them. They fall out. Sorry, that's a minor spoiler, but yeah. Come on, it's a film. There's got to be some conflict. Yeah, and things go on. And it's a good film. It's very... It's not tense. And I'll tell you why it's not tense. But there's a creeping sensation all the way through it that something is going to happen. And I didn't know what it was. And as I say, it's a true story, but I didn't know what those things were. But there's this creeping sense, because this guy's so weird, he's going, what is going to happen here? Why? He's so weird, something's going to go wrong. And it's good. And I enjoyed it. And I enjoyed it all the way to the end. I'll tell you why it's not absolutely brilliant. I'll tell you why I didn't find it gripping or tense per se. It's because the guy who directed it, can't remember his name. I don't know his name. He directed Moneyball. And if you've seen Moneyball, you'll know that that's a film without much flair in it. Again, it goes down to performances. And this film is exactly the same. It's very still. It's very static. It's... doesn't move around a lot. Wrestling is about two people who kind of like standing next to each other anyway. And the rest of the film is two people essentially in scenes talking to each other and not talking very much. These people aren't verbose. They struggle with words. They struggle with emotions. And they don't say much. And the film doesn't move along. And most of the shots are very still. It's a static film, and he also eschews the use of music pretty much. There's not an awful lot of incidental music going on in the background. You're kind of just sitting there with these two people for a lot of the time. Different people, but it's essentially that. Yeah, and it's slightly a problem. It's slightly a limitation on the excitement. You know, when music does come in, you go, oh Christ, what's going to happen here? And there are some key moments with that. It does work, but it's a slight limitation. It does make you are kind of going, yeah, it's never slow, but you're going, just do something a little bit more, please, please, please. The woman behind me, sitting behind me, went to the toilet twice during the performance. Might have been three times. And that's an indication, unless she'd had 6 pints, which she bloody would have done, wouldn't she? So, yeah, so that's Foxcatcher. I am also giving that one thrown, you know, it wasn't far off of two, neither was Fear of Everything in a way, but they're both one throwers. Anyway, that is that. Oh no, that's not that. Because into the woods, into the woods, into the woods we go. Into the woods, into the woods, and don't forget the festival. Into the woods, I saw just now. I'm just having some more wine. Into the Woods, yeah, directed by Rob Marshall, who did Chicago, and I think other musicals. I like a good musical. I like Les Mis the other year. I love Fiddler on the Roof, which I think is really good for its historical analyses. And I like Grease, of course, but who doesn't? But I like a musical. This is a musical. It starts musically, lots and lots of singing, not many spoken words, and it's from a Broadway thing, as these films tend to be. And it's about grim fairy tales, a mixing up of grim fairy tales, kind of a darker edge on them. Red Riding Hood, Rapunzel, Jack and the Beanstalk. There's another one. There's another big one. Who cares? But anyway, I've done that one. Yeah. And they all go into the woods and they all get mixed up, or they get all their adventures mixed up. Meryl Streep plays a witch who's kind of conjuring the affairs. James Corden and Emily Blunt play a baker and his wife. And Anna Kendrick plays Cinderella. That's the other one. She plays Cinderella. And a brattish little, my name is Red Riding Hood. Kid plays Red Riding Hood, really infuriatingly makes you want to leave the cinema. If the Knights of Nier were in these woods, suffice it to say, it is one of the voices the Knights of Nier cannot hear. She's really, really annoying, and I'm glad she goes out of it a bit early. She comes back though, the bitch. So they mix up all the fairy tales. There's magic beans, there's going to the ball, there's looking for love. They've got to find a man. And it's all very overacted and really, really fun. Meryl Streep is kind of, well, she's really overacting. James Corden, I quite liked. I've liked him since The Wrong Man's thing on the BBC. I didn't like him before that, but now he's in my like club. That's pretty good. Anna Kendrick's fine. Emily Blunt, she just lights up the screen. She's one of the great things in modern cinema. She's certainly one of the great British stars, I think. She always lights up the screen. She looks like she's having such a bloody laugh all the time. It's great, it's great. And she really made the film, made certainly the early parts of the film for me. And it goes along, and it goes along, and I was actually having quite a good time watching this. I hadn't been expecting to like it, but I did. And then, how much shall I reveal? Okay. There's a point where I thought it had ended, and I went, I actually liked that, and it was going to be a throner then. Pretty simple review for me. And then, of course, in plays, there are two acts, and it quite adheres to that quite strictly. And all this other stuff happened. I'd been having a rollicking time running around the woods just asking about these people. And then all this other stuff happened. And I just went, I don't want to know this. And all these issues, which had been kind of clouded by the fun aspects of the first act, sort of came to bear and had to be tied up. And they had to talk about parenthood and responsibilities and wishing and stuff. And I just went, I don't want that. The second part was a real downer for me. And I just basically wanted it to finish then. I'll leave it there. It looks fantastic, by the way. The woods and stuff is really, really good. It's entertaining. It's a high chair. It could have been so much more. It dipped down. You know, it nearly dipped. If it had gone on another 15 minutes, it would have been a low chair. But it's a high chair. It's a high chair. You can feed your baby in it. But that's Into the Woods, Into the Woods. It's worth a look, but only if you like musicals. If you do not, you will hate it. You'll just hate it from minute one. And those are the cinema ones. Let's go on to DVD and Robin Wright and a Penis-Headed Fish. This is a film called The Congress. It's from a book, I think, probably a short book. The Futurists Congress or something. But it's directed by Ari Folman, F-O-L, who did Waltz with Bashir. And so he's very, an animation about memory and about a conflict in the Middle East. And that was terrific. That was mesmerising. I really, really liked Waltz with Bashir. So I watched this, and it's an interesting film. It stars Robin Wright as an actress who, at the beginning of the film, she sells her image to Danny Houston, who is a studio head of a studio called Miramount. Miramax, Paramount, lovely. She sells her image, basically, and she retires, and that means that they can do anything with her image. And that's an interesting concept. Because, yeah, they track her, they photograph her from every angle. They can put her in any film. She can be anything. She ends up in this crap sci-fi series, which she really didn't want to do. And that's an interesting concept about, you know, who owns your intellectual property. You know, are actors just playthings, etc. And there are lots of good dialogue around that. And then the film shifts 20 years into the future. And she goes to this place. She turns up in a car and she's going to this place. And a guard says, oh, this is a cartoon-only place, you know. And she says, all right, and she sniffs this stuff, and she turns into a cartoon. And she just goes to this cartoon place. And everyone in the place is a cartoon. And there's this drug where people can sniff, and they can become anyone. So all in the background, there are loads of people. There are Beyonce, Michael Jackson, Cleopatra, Lots of really old 20s kind of cartoons, like Steamboat Willie, like old 40s Mickey Mouse people. Just, you catch them in the background and go, why is that guy there? It's really, really weird. And it's fucking weird. Abandoned Logic! Logic disembarks the ship. And you have this weird, nutty place where it's kind of lots of COD philosophy going on. John Hamm's in it from Mad Men. He's talking to her about what's going on. It doesn't matter what's going on. There's loads of cartoon characters going around. Oh, there's a revolution. There's an armed bloody assault. That's not a spoiler. That's fine. But none of this stuff makes any sense. So there's no spoilers, really. It's really, really odd. As I said, she looks in a fish tank and some of them have got massive helmet heads and some of them have got vaginas and they stick to the window for mouths. Very, very odd. She goes around. It's one of these kind of like a Matrix cartoon thing. Loads and loads of quotes if you're into your psytrance or something. It's really odd. It's an odd, odd film. I really liked it. Well, not I really liked it, but I liked it a lot. I enjoyed it. Lots of people have said the cartoon's crap. I was just watching going, what the F is this? It's absurd. Nothing makes sense. But hell, it's just go with it. Just watch it with smoking some weed. Not that I condone the use of drugs. Watch it smoking some weed or something. You'll just go, you'll probably turn it off actually. Just going, what the F is this? It's an odd one. It's a really odd one. I liked it. I'm definitely giving it a throne. It's one throne. It's not two, but yeah, give it a chance. The Congress. That was from last year. And the last film this week is The Expendables 3. Oh, God, I'm thirsty. The Expendables 3. I must admit, I expected to think this was really shit. And I had a sneaky bit of an enjoy of The Expendables 3. The reasons are because of people like Dolph Lundgren, Wesley Snipes, who turns up in it. I love the Stath. You gotta love the Stath. And they're fun. And Mel Gibson, who is the baddie in this one. And he is excellent. There's one scene in the van where he's really, really angry. And he's saying what he'd do to Barney Ross. And you see in his eyes that anger that unfortunately comes out in public when he's drunk and arrested and stuff. Or on the phone to people. But you see why he was a good actor, why he was good in Lethal Weapon, why he was good in Mad Max. And you see this anger and this hate of what he's going to do. And it's actually a mesmeric scene. You watch it and go, fuck, you're in a different film suddenly. And it's really, really good. But unfortunately, he's playing against Sylvester Stallone, who's like a lumpy turd shaped like a man. He's so bad in this film. He mucks it up in more ways than one. He gets all these youngsters, this crap guy called Kellan Lutz, who's a man who knows pain because he had to leave his unit and stuff. This stuff's so, it's duff. And I'm saying duff there. It's shit. It's rubbish. It's boring. And the reason Stallone messes it up again so much is because his character, Barney Ross, in all of these films is the worst character, the worst hero, the most boring twat I've ever come across in an action film. He always feels the pain. He's always sensitive. He knows he's always protecting everyone who doesn't even need protecting. He never really laughs except for these crappy, really clunky, you must have demented butt stuff. When he gets angry, he's got no emotion in his face in these things. He's utterly shit. He's the worst character I've ever come across. He's just shit. I hope there are no more of these. Or if they do, they just have Dolph Lundgren and Wesley Snipes and Jason Statham. Dolph Lundgren's been a revelation in these. He's so funny because he sort of takes the piss out of himself. Sylvester Stallone absolutely refuses to do that in these films. He mucks it up and he makes it rubbish. It's going to be a low chair. You know, I enjoyed it. It's got its moments. They're mainly about Mel Gibson and the people I've talked about before. But anyway, don't bother watching it particularly. But you might as well. There's some good action pieces. The young people are just dump. One last thing, and that is about the Oscars. Here is some salt. I washed my hands of the Oscars. No Gone Girl, no Lego Movie and the Animated Features, nothing for Jake Gyllenhaal in Nightcrawler. They don't like anything that's dark. You only get loads of stuff like Theory of Everything, safety bloody stuff. I won't have it. I'm not watching them. I'm not even going to watch them now.